just next door in 232 Eddy, where you can also submit paper applications. And again, we'll take questions for all the projects to end, and I'll invite Leah up here to present on 500 Church.
Hi everyone, thank you for having us here tonight. I'm going to present on 500 Turk Street, which is located at Turk and Larkin Street. So it's about a quarter of a mile from Market Street, about a third of a mile from Civic Center BART station. It's pretty near City Hall. I think this graphic does it a little bit more justice. So you can see the kind of major federal building there, if people are familiar with the area. City Hall is just north of that, and the Phoenix Hotel is just south of our site. So the brown coloring is our project site. The current use is Kahn and Cavill, an auto tire repair station, and they will be closing down. They have another shop in South San Francisco, so they're going to put all of their services in South San Francisco. And we've actually already purchased the site. They will stay on the site until we're ready to start construction. So this project will be 8 stories, and it will be type 1, which we've said in all of our presentations. That basically means it's made out of concrete all the way up. So there's just concrete built. It's going to be 108 total units with one manager's unit. We'll have over 100,000 square feet of residential space and about 1,800 square feet of retail space, so probably just enough for 2 small retailers. We have a variety of units here, but they will basically be 1, 2, and 3 bedrooms. We'll have 23 studios, 21 one-bedrooms, 52 bedrooms, and 14 three-bedrooms, for a total of 108 units. The unit mix for AMIs will be from 40% up to 60% AMI, and we also will have project-based Section 8 vouchers at this property. So folks who are able to apply for those vouchers only pay 30% of their income up to 50% AMI. Different amenities for the site. We will have a community room. We'll have a nice courtyard area out in back for residents to enjoy. We're looking at some ping pong tables. These are our 2 potential retail bays. So we're hoping for, you know, some neighborhood serving retail that folks can go to. We'll have a bike room, an on-site laundry room, mail corridor, kind of typical in our buildings. We will have resident services offices as well as property management offices on site for residents to use. Schedule wise, we are currently in design, so we just finished our schematic design, which is like pretty early design. We're still working with the city to get all of our permitting done. We will start construction probably in late 2019 and finish construction in fall of 2022. And then we're hoping to be fully leased up by spring of 2023. So we'll probably be marketing and looking for folks to start applying to move in, I would say, in late 2022 and early 2023. So it's a ways out there. And now we can take all questions for all projects.
Yeah. I noticed in the last statement that you were planning to change from the tables inside. There's many people who do various things, but not too many ping pong players.
Too many ping pong players?
Not too many in American grouping.
Yeah, I mean, it was an idea.
I haven't seen one every day. No, they're not. I'm being honest with you, not. I mean, there are some that would do that. I like ping pong personally. But
right.
It's just that I just can't see a whole lot of people running
down the
stairs
with ping pong.
I mean, a pool table would be nice, people like a pool, maybe ping pong also, and maybe some other kind of game. I think that'd be nice. If those things were incorporated in your plan, that'd be nice. That way, it'd be a variety. Some people would be feeling like they were left out.
I understand that, yeah.
Could you maybe explain a little bit more about who would qualify to live in the different buildings? Like, I, you know, a lot of, for example, residents here are all majority living on SSI or some other form of disability or Social Security. Like, are any of these buildings, would these people be able to apply or qualify for any of those type of units? Or are we talking about the employee folks with higher incomes? I mean, like, just like an idea of who actually is eligible.
Yeah, so I can go back. I had a slide with income levels on it. So a lot of these buildings have sort of two different sort of, I guess, tier might be the right word to use. So they're what we call the general population units, which are, don't have a voucher or anything like that associated with the units. And so they're usually about 50% or 60% of area median income is the maximum. So anyone making under that would be able to qualify, and it's a lottery-based system. So here you can see what the current 50% area median incomes are. The larger your family, the higher that can be, because you have potentially two income earners. So it's in the 40s, roughly, now, and that probably will raise by the time, you know, 2023 comes around. Inflation raises that, and then we see here the homeless families. That's a referral process through the Department of Homelessness and Supportive Housing. Those are very, very low income individuals who are currently experiencing homelessness or are at risk of homelessness. And their maximum is usually about 25% AMI, so you can match about half of that, and they would pay a third of their income no matter what their income is, and then a voucher program for the city sort of backfills that to a more level. But for the majority of the units, it's around this sort of this level, and the typical rent, although this changes depending on the year, it's a federal rent level. You know, it would be for like a one-bedroom apartment, it would be around $1,000, $1,100 is where they are now at 1036 Mission, which is leasing up right now. So that's present, but that, you know, by the time 2023 comes around, it changes every year a little bit.
And in my property, so we have those project-based Section 8 vouchers. So that would be, again, any person that gets the voucher. I think they apply through the San Francisco Housing Authority. Would just pay 30% of their income. So, you know, that would be really, like, anyone could qualify if they meet under 50% AMI for those units. And then the remainder of the units are at 40% AMI, so they're actually a little bit under these incomes right here. And then there's some at 50 and some at 60, so kind of stepping up.
Okay, I think what we're talking about here might be teachers, who are notoriously low paid, and also retail clerks, people that work in hospitals, people that make just above the minimum wage, maybe, you know, I mean, this is kind of these people that really need to have a place to live, especially if they work in the city.
I would agree with that statement, yeah.
The people that live in these buildings are of all different professions. It's not picked and chosen based on what those professions are, mm-hmm. but someone making about $40,000 a year would be a lot of those individuals. Teachers span a lot, you know, a beginning teacher mm-hmm. would probably qualify, but some teachers can make, you know, $70,000, $80,000 if they're very experienced and been around for a long time, so they might not qualify. So it's really just based on—
We'll get the young ones.
Their income level. The young ones, definitely people making minimum wage would qualify and be able to afford living that was affordable.
I have one worry. Is what the I think his name's Peter, whatever his name is, who's the secretary of HUD, and his insane idea that people on fixed incomes like SSI need to pay more rent, wanting to raise the 30% to 35%. adjustments in case not happens, heaven forbid.
I'm not aware that change hasn't happened.
It hasn't. It's still in the proposal phase, according to my information from Washington.
Yeah, if for those programs, if they make a change, that would be a change that would affect
the entire industry.
Those vouchers. We can't control that, unfortunately. We certainly would absolutely advocate against that. And that would only impact, I think you're the only project that has Section 8 vouchers. The rest of these projects where you pay a third of their income, they're San Francisco programs, they're not federal programs. So it wouldn't affect, for example, these 40 units for homeless families. That's a City of San Francisco based program.
Right. Because there's a lot of opposition in Congress to that.
Yeah.
I hope so.
TNDC is part of a lot of organizations that would vocally push against a change like that.
Also, on 500 Church Street, I sent a letter of support. I think I emailed it to all of you on your variances that you asked for. I've also sent letters of support for the entire project, for the draft hearing, and I'll do so again for the final hearing.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
We got our CEQA certification done, and we are waiting for our variance determination letter. So they are pushing back on a couple of our variances, but we're hoping to work it out with the planning department.
Are there any plans in the mix for later on down the road where you have been going up for people who don't necessarily have houses? Yeah, working families, they do need it and all that. Kids need support and all that. But I mean, down the road, is there anything foreseen where they might start building for the benefit of helping the people who are marginally undercast financially so they can get off the street and have a home for themselves? It might not be the amount of money that's being put out in these situations, but it's got to be something that I can do.
Yeah, well, I think Nick's project, if you are a formerly homeless individual, so you're living on the street, the first step would be make sure they get registered with the Department of HSH, Housing and Supportive.
Homeless and Supportive Housing.
Thank you. So make sure they get registered in their databases. And then they actually are available to get into our buildings when we have homeless unit set asides.
Yeah, so for example, 1036 Mission is half of the units will be for families experiencing homelessness.
On the 500 Turk project,
yeah.
What are they doing to what are the plans? You know, the sign has been one of those issues that everybody wants to talk about and is excited about.
Absolutely.
And you're like, what are we going to do about that? Beautiful sign that has all the great sayings.
Yeah, one of the things we're looking
at
is putting it into our courtyard. So back here, you can see there's words up there. And right now it looks more permanent, but we're talking with the architect about actually making it changeable so that we can update it with some of the same quotes that they're using on the sign. And right now you can see directly from the street through the lobby into the courtyard. So it's not as visible, and I think that's something that we're talking about with the architect about, you know, we really know the community appreciates this, so how do we make sure they're still able to see the sayings? We do have to incorporate one of the Goodyear signs, so we're also trying to figure out, like, do we put it in the community room, do we put it in the courtyard, do we put it back on the roof? So those are conversations we're currently having. But yeah, it's required for us to do, and we want to. It's pretty cool.
I would like to push for it to be as visible to the public as possible, because that was like the one sort of thing that everybody I've talked to like really brings up. They're all for the building there, they're all for the housing, but everybody always asks, well, what about the sign? What are we going to do to save the sign? So
give it sorry.
Community can see it.
Yeah.
Give it landmark status.
It is actually on the historic register, so we went through a historic evaluation process with the city, and one of the requirements for us to be able to build the site was to do something about the sign to make sure that we're reincorporating it back into the project somehow.
Good.
So, yeah, we're actively working on that with the architect right now.
Mm-hmm.
which one was the one that was through the Housing Authority, and is that have units that a single person could move into?
So it would be project-based Section 8, and the PBB units, so there are one bedrooms, so I do believe a single person could live and qualify for one of those one bedrooms.
Which one is that?
So that's on 500 Turk Street.
500 Turk, okay.
Yeah, if you look at the unit mix slide.
Studio and one bedroom.
Yeah, we don't have any studios for those project-based shelter units, but we do have one bedrooms.
Oh.
Any other questions? Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for having us. Wait, I have a comment. I mean, I haven't found out where 500 Turk is, so I can look at it.
It's the last
one.
The Goodyear tire place is closed.
Yeah, but what the mix? Okay.
All the rest is.
Yeah, I have a comment.
Sure.
It starts with a question, actually. What would you say is the typical square feet for a studio? Just so I'm in the same understanding of the world as you.
I am not sure off the top of my head. Well, I want to say it ranges between 360 square feet to 500 square feet.
Okay, that's cool.
Do you happen to know?
Let's say 425. Okay, how about one bedroom?
Range across his project.
Keep it moving, one bedroom. What is that?
Probably be 550 to 600.
Okay, two bedrooms, keep it coming.
800 to 900, 750 to 850.
How about three?
That's usually 950 to 1200. 1036s are about 1100.
Okay, here's my general comment, especially the Turk Street one that is actually could be step up housing for the hotels. You know, they're not building new land in San Francisco. There's a tremendous demand. Mm-hmm. I think you have to be realistic about the size of units that you're building. Mm-hmm. Most of the people in here, I'm living in 165 square feet. Most of the people in here are in the range of 200 square feet, although there actually are some studio one bedroom apartments in this building, which is more like, I don't know, 300 square feet. Mm-hmm. I mean, these are small units, and there's a tremendous demand, especially ones if you're talking about a single adult. You gotta be looking at efficiencies and small studios, more of that in the mix, and more one bedrooms. If families want to live in San Francisco, they have to accept that they're gonna have to be, you know, accept a little bit tighter. And we had a presentation in this room about global sea level rising. When you build smaller units, they take less energy. It's less of a demand. So, you know, I think you have to be realistic about the 21st century and the third millennium. I believe when you go to European countries, which are facing the same kind of stresses we're facing now, high density, low resource, the units are all smaller.
Cubicles, in other words.
No, you know, I started out over at the Arity, which is 80 square feet. A single person can live in 80 square feet. In fact, they had a couple with a baby living in 80 square feet for a period of time. I mean, there's a lot of units in San Francisco. You know what? Undocumented, you don't see them as homeless because they're at risk if they're homeless of getting, you know, swept up. Mm-hmm. But what you see is those undocumented people, they're living four people in a studio. And that's how they do it.
Yeah, and unfortunately, because we have financing that comes from the city and from the federal government, they actually have very strict requirements about how many people can live in a unit per square foot.
Right. So I understand that, but small, you can design projects with smaller units. The Kelly Cullen over here, those are 220 square feet, and they're wonderful. Mm-hmm. They have full bathroom and full kitchen. Well, more or less, a big kitchen area.
Yeah, we try to build as many units as possible for that. We're often very close to the legal minimum in terms of square footage. A lot of those 80 square foot certainly would actually be illegal to build.
What would?
That's by the planning code.
Planning code and several different financing sources that we have requirements.
You know, it's a largesse of what is obviously, you know, ultimately taxpayer money. Maybe there's some philanthropy in there as well, but it's not the way to stretch the money to get the need when there's obviously a huge need.
Yes.
Yeah, we totally agree there's a need, and